The third talk is given by Francisco Anna Mayer. He will talk about the maximal tolerable excess noise in continuous variable QKD and improve the lower bound on two-way capacities. Please.
Okay. Thank you for the organization of this talk. This is a joint work with Ludovico Lami and Vittorio Giovannetti about our recent paper. And in this talk, we find an expression for the maximum tolerable noise in the in optical quantum key distribution. And we provide improved lower bounds on the two-way capacities. The outline of my talk is the following. I will first give a motivation behind our work. Then I will explain the basics of quantum communication. Then I will introduce the best studied model of optical link, that is the thermal attenuator quantum channel. And then I will explain our results, that are an expression for the maximum tolerable noise in optical QKD and entanglement distribution, and improved protocols for these tasks. The motivation of our work is that is the future quantum internet. Future quantum internet will rely on long-distance quantum communication. And long-distance quantum communication needs quantum repeaters. Quantum repeaters are devices that can be put every few tens or hundreds of kilometers along the communication line to achieve long-distance quantum communication. However, quantum repeaters nowadays are still at the level of proof of principle experiments. And even if in the future they will be built in large scale, they will likely be expensive to build and maintain. So an important problem is to optimize quantum communication protocols in the absence of quantum repeaters, in the absence of these fragile devices. And in our work, we find an expression for the maximum tolerable noise in QKD entanglement distribution without quantum repeaters, and improved protocols without quantum repeaters. The framework of quantum communication theory is the following. We have two parties, Alice and Bob, that are distant apart, and they are separated by a communication line that is affected by noise. The noise is mathematically characterized by a quantum channel. And Alice and Bob, their goal is to perform some quantum communication tasks. For example, entanglement distribution. And entanglement distribution means that by using the channel, Alice and Bob want to distill an e-bit. E-bit is just this maximally entangled state. And another quantum communication task is qubit distribution from Alice to Bob, and also secret key distribution. In this scenario, since Alice and Bob are very distant apart, the meaningful set of operations that we consider is the set of LOCC operation, that is local operation and classical communication. So local operation in their labs. And now let us define the so-called capacities of quantum channels. The capacities of a quantum channel are a figure of merit of quantum communication performances across a quantum channel. The higher the capacities, the better the communication performance. And for each of the before mentioned quantum communication tasks, one can define a suitable notion of capacity. For example, for the task of secret key distribution, one can define a secret key capacity. The secret key capacity is the maximum over all the possible LOCC strategies of the so-called rate. The rate is the number of distributed secret key bits and the number of uses of the channel. Analogously, one can define for the task of entanglement distribution. For this task, one can define the two-way quantum capacity. And the two-way quantum capacity is defined as the maximum over all the possible heliocentric strategies of the rate of E bit. And I want to remark a simple inequality between these two quantities. Indeed, if one has an entanglement distribution strategy, so if one distill an E-bit, then can use the Eckert protocol to distill a secret key. Eckert protocol is an LOCC protocol. So basically, the secret key capacity is also always larger or equal to the two-way quantum capacity. And before I said that the two-way quantum capacity is the capacities for distribution of entanglement, but it is also the capacity for the transmission of qubit. Indeed, when LOCC are free, entanglement distribution and qubit distribution are two equivalent tasks because of quantum teleportation. Because if you can distill an E-bit, then quantum teleportation protocol allows you to transmit a qubit. And conversely, if you are able to transmit an arbitrary qubit, you are also able to transmit an half of an E-bit. So the two-way quantum capacity is also the capacity for transmission of entanglement. Now let us talk about optical links. We are in the framework of quantum optics and the quantum information with continuous variable systems. The quantum systems under consideration is basically the quantum harmonic oscillator. So we have an annihilation operator A, the corresponding vacuum at zero, and the nth Fock state that corresponds to the state with n photons in the mode. And basically, we are considering a qubit with a dimension equal to infinity. We want to model optical links such as optical fibers or free space links. And in optical links, two parameters come into play, that are the transmissivity lambda, that is defined as the probability that a single photon that is input into the optical link is transmitted to the output. So it's basically the transmissivity is the probability that a single photon reaches the output. And then we have also another parameter that is the thermal noise. No, the thermal noise energy that affects the optical link, because the optical link is in an environment that has some temperature different from zero, and there is a thermal background. And so some photons can affect your signals into the transmission. So let us fix these two parameters, the transmissivity lambda in 0, 1, and the thermal noise that is a positive number, no. And let us define the best studied model in the literature of an optical link that described losses in optical link. This model is the so-called thermal attenuator channel. The thermal attenuator channel is a quantum channel defined by this construction. The thermal attenuator channel takes the input state, rho, and mixes this state in a beam splitter. It is a semi-reflective mirror of transmissivity lambda with a thermal state of mean photon number nu. And the output at this arm of the beam splitter is exactly the output of the thermal attenuator channel. So the thermal attenuator channel acts on the input state rho in this way. It couples it with a thermal state in a beam splitter of transmissivity lambda, and then it traces out the environment. This is the beam splitter unitary, but it's not important for our discussion. And this is the expression of the thermal state. I want just to remark that this thermal state has the property that if you compute the expectation value of the photon number operator, the expectation value is just nu. So nu is the mean photon number of the environment. Just to forge our intuition, let us give two examples. If the transmissivity is equal to one, then the thermal attenuator is noiseless. If the transmissivity is zero, the channel is completely noisy. Now I want to give an open problem. The open problem is to determine the two-way capacities, the capacities of the thermal attenuator. This problem has been solved in the particular case in which the thermal noise is equal to zero. And this formula of the capacity is called the Plobb bound. And this is the maximum achievable rate across an optical link of transmissivity lambda, of rate of qubit and e-bit. So the open problem is to derive the expression of the capacities for when the thermal noise is strictly larger than zero, when the temperature of the environment is larger than zero. And a particular case of this open problem one, I called it open problem two, is to determine all the values of the parameter, of the noise parameter, where the two-way capacities are strictly larger than zero. This is meaningful because the capacities are strictly larger than zero if and only if the corresponding quantum communication tasks are achievable. So if I determine the region of parameters where the capacities are larger than zero, I can determine where I can do quantum key distribution and tangent distribution. And this open problem has been identified as a crucial open problem, open question by the, basically the same author of the Plobb bound. And in our paper, we solve this open problem, and we find this simple characterization. So the capacities are strictly larger than zero if and only if the transmissivity is larger than this ratio. And this can provide a benchmark on quantum repeaters when you need a quantum repeater on your optical fiber. So our results are the following. Regarding open problem one, we find state-of-the-art lower bounds on the two-way capacities, and we solve open problem two. Since the proof of this if and only if is very simple, I sketch the proof. So one implication, so if the transmissivity is smaller than this value, the capacities are equal to zero, is simple, it was already known, because it was known that if the transmissivity is smaller than this value, the channel, the thermal attenuator is entanglement breaking. And the entanglement breaking channels are known to have zero two-way capacities. So this was the simple direction. Now let us show the non-trivial implication. We want to show that if the transmissivity is larger than this value, then the capacities are strictly larger than zero. In order to do that, we exhibit an explicit entanglement distribution protocol, and we show that its e-bit rate is strictly larger than zero. Since the capacities are the maximum over all the possible strategies of the rate, this will provide the proof of our result. So the step one of our protocol is the following. Alice produces in her lab n copies of this state, vacuum, vacuum, plus single photon, single photon. Then step two, Alice sends the B halves via n uses of the thermal attenuator. So after Bob receives all the signals by Alice, then Alice and Bob share n copies of this state. And now I want to give you an intuition before telling you the step three. By construction, the input state was lived in the subspace of vacuum and single photon. So if Bob finds on his part more than one photon, if, for example, he finds two or three photons, he knows that thermal noise has acted. So this is the intuition behind step three. Step three, Bob, on each system, Bob performs a projective measurement in order to understand whether or not the signal is on the subspace of vacuum and single photon. So this projector on this subspace. And if the outcome is no, then they decided to discard the state. If the outcome is yes, then they keep the state. And let us denote rho AB, the state, after the measurement and after the outcome yes. Now let us do two observations. The first observation is that by construction, rho AB lives in a qubit tensor qubit subspace. Then the second observation is that by a direct calculation, one can show that rho AB is entangled if the transmissivity is larger than this value. And then we exploit this fact that it is known that any qubit tensor qubit entangled state is distillable. Distillable means that there exists an LUCC that allows you to start from many copies of the state and to distill EBIT with a strictly positive rate. So the step four of this protocol is just to apply this entanglement distillation protocol that arises from this fact. And so Aries and Bob can distill EBIT with a strictly positive rate. So since the capacity, since the true quantum capacity is the maximum over all the possible strategies of the rate, now we have found this lower bound, and so also this lower bound, because the secret capacity is always larger or equal to the true quantum capacity. Okay, this is the proof of our result. Now, I want to mention that we find also state-of-the-art lower bounds on the two-way capacities. We do this by introducing an explicit entanglement distribution protocol and by calculating its rate of EBITs. And the entanglement distribution protocol that we construct is just an optimization of the entanglement distribution protocol that I talked before in the proof of the previous result. And where, for example, we optimize over the input state, over the measurement, and over the details of the entanglement of the final entanglement distillation protocol. For example, in the number of the step of the entanglement the recurrence protocol, and the so-called and also improved version of the final part that is called the hashing protocol. But these are just details that are hidden in the final entanglement distillation protocol of the step four. So, okay, by introducing this explicit entanglement distribution protocol and by calculating its rate, we have our lower bound. I plot the bounds on the capacities in this figure. The green line is the upper bound on the capacities. It is bound by the same outer of Plot bound. And then these three lines are the lower bound. Our lower bound is the red one. It turns out that it is the best lower bound when the transmissivity is sufficiently small. And also our lower bound is faithful in the sense that it is strictly larger than zero if and only if the capacities are strictly larger than zero. And okay, so in our paper, we also consider other quantum channels, the thermal amplifier and the additive Gaussian noise. And in general, all the so-called single mode phase insensitive Gaussian channels. And we consider also energy constraint at the input of the channel. And all the results that I mentioned are valid also in this situation. For example, the formula that of where the capacity, the formula for the noise parameter where the capacities are still larger than zero is independent of the energy constraint. And then we consider also other types of entanglement distribution protocols, different from the one that I presented. And that are the so-called multi-rail strategies. And okay, in conclusion, in our paper, we find an expression for the minimum tolerable transmissivity of an optical link that is provided by this simple ratio. in terms of thermal noise. And this formula provides a benchmark for quantum repeaters, because the length of an optical fiber is related to the transmissivity of the optical fiber. And so this formula provides you the maximum length of an optical fiber to have a quantum key distribution without quantum repeaters. So if you have, for example, an optical fiber that is longer than this maximum length, that you have no hope to use your optical fiber for quantum key distribution without putting a quantum repeater in the middle. And so, for example, let us do a crude estimate for typical parameters. For example, for telecom wavelengths, if we do QKD across commercial optical fiber without quantum repeaters, QKD is achievable only if the optical fiber is smaller than 700 kilometers. This is derived by using this formula. And okay, so this is a benchmark for quantum repeaters. And in our work, we also find improved lower bounds on the two-way capacities. And we do this by providing fully explicit entanglement distribution protocols. Thank you for the attention.
Okay, so thank you, Francisco. Okay.
Thanks for the nice talk. What's the idea behind the upper bound?
Sorry?
What's the idea behind the upper bound, the green curve that you showed?
What is the idea?
The idea behind the upper bound.
The idea behind?
Yeah.
Ah, okay, okay. The idea behind the upper bound is the thermal attenuator, that is a Gaussian channel, okay? It turns out that all the Gaussian channel are teleportation simulable. Teleportation simulable means that you can simulate your channel via LOCC via their choice state. So basically, I'm telling that for teleportation simulable channel, basically, their capacities, their two-way capacities, are equal to the corresponding distillable entanglement or distillable key of their choice state. And then, the secret capacity, the two-way quantum capacity is equal to the distillable entanglement of the choice state. And then the distillable entanglement is upper bounded by the so-called relative entropy of entanglement. And then they find an upper bound on the relative entropy of entanglement, and they find this upper bound. This is the basic idea. You're welcome.
Okay, I want to ask a question. So could you please go to the conclusion page?
Sorry?
The conclusion page, the last page
of
your slide. Okay, yes. So I think your result is about the achievability, right?
Yes.
But in the example, you show that the repeatedness QKD is achievable. I understand. Yeah, this is also about achievability. And so, if the fiber length is less, longer than 700 kilometers, then it should be, basically it should be achievable by your methods, right?
Yes, yes, the fact that if the transmissivity is smaller than this value, then these tasks are not achievable, this was already known because the channel is entanglement breaking. But we show that if the transmissivity is larger than this value, then these tasks are achievable.
But I think you should it is achievable if, I mean, it should be not only if you write only if is the is the necessary requirement.
Sorry, right? I didn't understand the question.
I think that your result implies that the condition should be the sufficient condition, not a necessary condition.
Ah, yes, it's an if and only if. Yes.
Okay.
Hello, thank you for a nice talk. In your work, you compute the lower bound of the secret key capacity by distributing a two-qubit state. If you use the channel to distribute like two qubit states, can you improve the two-way capacity bound?
By using this kind of strategies, we optimize the also on the input states. We optimize also on the these input states. So you are asking me if we add, for example, also plus two.
Yeah, that's right.
The answer is no. The optimal state is always of Schmidt rank two. So only two terms here. But the optimal one is not when we put one single photon here, but the optimal one depends on the parameters. And sometimes is, for example, vacuum plus FOC2. Sometimes it's FOC3. But to optimize the rate. But is never larger than, for example, FOC4.
Okay.
But it's not always this one, the optimal.
Okay,
so, but considering Q-dit, so considering maximum entangled state with a Schmidt rank larger than two, decrease the rate.
Okay, thank you. I have another question. If I understand correctly, the lower bound you proved and match the PLOV upper bound for a specific class of quantum channels.
Yes.
So for you also mentioned another two class of quantum channels like Gaussian. So the upper bound also meets the lower bound.
Ah yes. Yes. The upper bound by PLOB can be generalized over all the possible single mode phase insensitive Gaussian channels that are, for example, two examples are the quantum channels that you mentioned, thermal amplifier and the Gaussian noise. And also our protocol we can apply to these channels. And for any, for these channels, the upper bound vanishes if and only if the lower bound that we find vanishes. Thank you for the question.
Okay, let's thank the speaker again.
Thank you.